Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome from Munich. Thank you for joining us from over 80 countries. My name is Stéphane Barbot-Maire. I'm the Chief Content Officer at VIVA Technology and your host for this very first event organized by the new Observatory on Patents and Technology of the European Patent Office. We are together this morning to talk about startups and how intellectual property can boost things up. When the European Patent Office reached out to VIVA Tech to collaborate on this project, we were immediately interested to join the conversation. We've been talking extensively at VIVA Tech about the difficulties for deep tech startups to go from lab to market, and it's clear that IP and patents are the key in the journey of a startup growth and prosperity. Despite the ongoing crisis that's affecting all of us, the European Patent Office has seen a record demand for patents in 2022 with almost 200K applications. And since last June, as you all know, the unitary patent is effective for 17 countries in Europe with great demand so far and small businesses at the forefront of applications. So what's on the menu this morning? Well, we have a new study on startup finance, patents and trademarks. And then we will have a demo of the new and free Deep Tech Finder, which merges the worlds of business data and patent data. And then a conversation on how to leverage patents and other IP rights for startups and investors. If you want to participate or ask questions, you can write in the chat. All our speakers will join a Q&A session at the end. But first and foremost, let me welcome António Campinos, the president of the European Patent Office, who has a few words for us today.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us this morning. There is no better way to kick off the first event for our new Observatory on Patents and Technology than by examining a topic that is critical to the future of innovation, boosting startups with the help of intellectual property. Because startups are at the heart of innovation, they are catalysts of growth and progress. Their inventions can help us to tackle the challenges facing humanity, the same threats that are having dire consequences for our world. We have all seen the wildfires burning across Southern Europe or Canada, the need for energy security, clean water. Technology can deliver solutions to these problems, and inventions will help us safeguard the planet for future generations. Because when we innovate, we create millions of jobs, healthier societies, higher productivity, a chance to reach net zero. And the rewards reach across borders, improving lives around the world. That's real sustainable impact. Behind all this lies a robust patent system that gives invention the best possible chance to perform at their best. Patents are essential for driving innovation in an economy. Across Europe, industries using IP rights intensively already contribute for almost half of the EU GDP. To put that in perspective, it's equivalent to the combined GDP of Germany, Benelux, and Poland. Today, we will turn the page on another chapter in our understanding of the impact of IP with the launch of our joint study with the EUIPO to help answer those all important questions. Do patents and trademarks unlock financial opportunities for European startups? And how? Can we better understand IP ownership across different European countries, across different industries? What we do know is that far too often, brilliant ideas are left unsupported and lack the funding they need. But patents are helping to rewrite the narrative, attracting financial support for technical breakthroughs, because startups filing European patent applications during the seed or early growth stage are around 5 times more likely to secure funding. We also know that, on average, nearly 30% of European startups have obtained registered IP rights, primarily within the areas of biotech, science, engineering, and healthcare, all sectors steering our society towards a more sustainable future. But we can do better, because Europe is trailing behind other regions, such as the US, in startup financing. So now is the time to close that gap and make sure that more and more of our startups tap into the power of patents to secure financing, to take their ideas from the lab to market. To achieve this, we have to make our patent system more accessible. As we mark 50 years of progress since the signing of the European Patent Convention this year, we are reminded that our patent system thrives on diversity, collaboration, and inclusivity, and that we have to open the door wider for startups and individual inventors. The launch of the unitary patent this year has indeed made the patent system more appealing to deep tech ventures, because it reduces the costs and complexity associated with validating and maintaining patents individually in each European state. Today, patent holders can pay a single renewal fee in a single currency under a single legal protection. Maximum protection, minimum administrative burden. The benefits are clear. In a matter of months, we have already over 11,000 requests for unitary effect on recently granted European patents. Many more, many from smaller businesses. In fact, over 4 in 10 are from SMEs and research institutions. So the unitary patent is crucial for ensuring every voice finds its place at the innovation table. If we don't achieve that, it will restrict our potential to transform societies and transform lives. Catalin Carico, who won the European Inventor Award for Lifetime Achievement last year, and more recently, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine, serves as an inspiring example of an individual inventor who, together with her team, paved the way for the COVID vaccine, saving millions of lives around the world. Her remarkable contributions remind us that innovation can spring from any corner, and when nurtured through patents, they can make a big difference. So to all the entrepreneurs and innovators out there who are responding to these challenges, I want to say the patent system is here to help you, whether that is through high quality, legally robust patents, or free access to over 140 million patent documents in our EspaceNet database. And our patent translate tool that provides on-the-fly translations in over 30 languages for all these documents. Then there are initiatives like our clean energy and firefighting platforms that provide access to patent information about the latest inventions in these topical fields. We must also provide a platform that allows us all to debate the latest trends in technology, so we are better placed to make decisions that put us on the path to a sustainable future, a path we have to navigate transparently, reaching out to as many stakeholders as possible. That's precisely why, on this 50th year of the EPC, we created our Observatory on Patents and Technology to strengthen outreach and contribute to a deeper understanding of the future of patents and technology together with private and public stakeholders. As part of these efforts, we are also delighted to be launching our Deep Tech Finder, a free digital tool to help investors detect and assess European startups that are bringing disruptive inventions to market in critical technology areas. This is a new compass with which to navigate the innovation landscape with a unique blend of business information and patent data to help investors connect with innovators. Already over 7,500 European startups across diverse tech sectors have had their profiles linked to their patents, unlocking invaluable insight for inventors. We are also enabling detailed patent searches in the smart industry and clean energy sectors, with plans to expand into even more tech sectors in the future. Fundamentally, the Deep Tech Finder is a vital part of the answer to the question raised by our study. How do we make sure that promising ideas get the funding they need? Another significant step towards a more sustainable patent system that works for everyone. So I will end here by saying thank you to everyone who's contributed to the study and to the Deep Tech Finder, and to all those involved with staging this event, as well as all the participants joining us today. We have a diverse panel for this important topic. Individuals who can share their experiences as founders and investors. I'm also delighted to welcome Mr. Scheffer, the President of the Board of the European Invention Council. Thank you for taking the time to be with us. And on that note, I wish you all a very enjoyable and productive event. Thank you.
Thank you, Antonio. And good morning, Yann. Thank you for joining us. Filing for a patent and trademark results in the protection of your innovation. And a protected idea is one that attracts investment. And Yann, who's here with me, will not disagree. So we have more on this with a joint study by the European Patent Office and the EUIPO, providing the first ever assessment of how patent and trademark applications impact startup finance. So let me welcome in our studio with me Yann Ménière, the chief economist of the European Patent Office, and joining us from Spain, Nathan Wajsman, the chief economist of the EUIPO. Good morning to both of you. Good morning, Nathan. Don't forget that you can ask your question about the study in the chat, and we will answer them after. Yann, Nathan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Stéphane, and good morning, everyone. It's a real pleasure for me to be here today with Nathan to present you this new study on intellectual property and its interplay with venture capital investment in Europe. But before moving to the substance of the study, let me first make a step back and quickly explain you why, in the first place, we were interested in addressing this topic together. Actually, the EPO and the European Patent, the EUIPO, have been working together for now about 10 years to assess and analyze the economic impact of intellectual property in Europe. And every third year, we jointly publish an assessment of the contribution of IP right-intensive industries to the EU economy. In the last edition of this study, we show that these industries actually are a major building block of the European Union's economy. Together, they generate about 47% of the EU's GDP and 39% of the EU's employment, usually highly paid jobs. They are also responsible for the bulk of the EU's trade, be it externally or trade between EU countries. Well, most of these industries use trademarks intensively across a wide range of markets. In comparison, the group of patent-intensive industries, so industries that use patent intensively, is more compact. It typically consists of industries that have manufacturing activities and that invest massively in research and development. Think aeronautics, automotive, pharmaceuticals, biotechnology, chemicals, semiconductors, or telecoms. Together, alone, they represent about 70% of the EU's GDP and 70% of the union's employment. Now, it's important to bear in mind that these industries not only consist of large multinational companies. In fact, they are rooted in rich ecosystems involving also research institutions and many small businesses, most of which are highly intensive as well. So it is important for us to also understand how these different types of businesses are making use of intellectual property rights and how they benefit from it. So we have a number of other studies focusing on this question. And this is quite an exciting question to address because the results are very interesting. Indeed, we find in these studies that SMEs, small businesses, benefit even more from intellectual property rights than large companies. For instance, we show that small businesses enjoy a 68% revenue premium as compared with when they use IP, as compared with SMEs that do not use IP. And in contrast, the premium for large firms, the revenue premium from large firms is only 18%. So there's a strong impact on SMEs. Likewise, in another study, we have examined the case of SMEs that file patents and trademark and check their ability to grow subsequently in the next years. And we do find a strong correlation between the use of intellectual property rights and subsequent growth. Actually, SMEs with intellectual property rights are 21% more likely to grow in the subsequent years. And this likelihood even increases further in the case of the use of European intellectual property rights, so European trademarks or European patents. Then the likelihood is plus 26% for SMEs with European IP rights compared with other SMEs. So in other words, our recent studies clearly suggest that intellectual property rights can and do make a big difference for European small businesses. They are a way to signal those businesses that are truly innovative, and they also enable these businesses to capture, protect their intellectual assets and to leverage them to nurture growth subsequently. So obviously, this is why we were interested in startups. Startups are the excellent example of recent small businesses that innovate, can make a difference, and we need to understand more about the way in which they can and do leverage intellectual property rights. Startups are also a very important topic nowadays in Europe. because they are increasingly central in the European economy. They are recognized as an engine of economic growth in Europe. The startups ecosystem have been growing massively in Europe during the past decade, and they are now recognized as a very valuable tool to address some of the key European challenges of today: digitalization, industrial renaissance, or sustainability, including by developing frontier technologies through deep tech startups. So there's a strong interest in supporting the startup ecosystem. There's also yet a recognition that Europe is still lagging the United States, for instance, in developing its startup ecosystem. There's no lack of skill and technology expertise in Europe, but there's still a funding gap with respect to the US. And this issue has been compounded in recent years by the COVID and then by the recent monetary policy tightening that led to a decline of investment opportunities in European startups. So this is a very good moment for us to check whether IP rights can make a difference in helping startups in Europe access venture capital investment. And this is precisely the purpose of this new study. With this study, we wanted first to map the use of European startups to the use of IP rights, so to understand what are the European startups that are filing trademarks or patents. And then we wanted to check whether this use of IP rights can make a difference in helping these startups access venture capital, or further on, if they could play a role in facilitating successful exit strategies for investors. So this is the study that we are now going to present you. And as a first step, I would just like to give you an overview of the population of startups that we have been considering. So for this study, we have been systematically mapping the Crunchbase database of startups to the registers of patents and trademarks in Europe. And thereby, we were able to identify those that are using IP rights. And overall, in total, we find that 29% of European startups have applied for registered IP rights, such as trademarks or patents. But of course, they are not evenly distributed across sectors. So what the chart that you can see on screen shows is that some sectors that are especially technology-oriented, technology-intensive, use much more frequently IP rights. So the first of them is biotechnology, with about 50% of startups having filed patents and trademarks. And likewise, you find a high intensity of use of intellectual property rights among startups in science and engineering, in healthcare, in manufacturing, in artificial intelligence. There are also some sectors that do not use patents that frequently, but that use trademarks more intensively, like financial services, for instance, or food and beverage. So starting from this population of startups, our next step is to understand what the use of IP rights can trigger for them in terms of facilitated access to finance. And for this part of the study, I will give the floor to my friend and colleague, Nathan. Nathan, over to you.
Thank you very much, Ian. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So as a first step, we present you some descriptive statistics from the study. On this chart, you can see the population, the sample of the startups as they progress through the various rounds of financing, from seed to early stage to late stage financing. And of course, the vast majority of the companies, of the startups in our sample, are in the seed financing category. The numbers decline as we move to the later stages, reflecting the simple facts that not all startups succeed. So some startups get the seed financing, but do not progress beyond that. What is, however, important to note here is that as we progress through the financing stages, the use of IP rights becomes more and more prevalent. For example, if we look at trademarks, we see that when it comes to the seed financing, 8% of the startups have applied for a trademark, 10% have applied for patents, and 5% have applied for both a trademark and a patent. When it comes to the early stage financing, these percentages rise to 53% for trademarks, 28% for patents, and 18% for a bundle of the two, respectively. And finally, in the late stage, 72% of the companies that get to that stage have applied for a trademark prior to getting financing, 44% have applied for a patent and 35% have applied for both. So the use of both types of IP rights clearly increases as we move through the financing stages. And even more pronounced is the fact that the use of European as opposed to just national IP rights is particularly prevalent. And this is especially true for patents. You see that in the rightmost panel of the chart. So for example, in the seed stage already, among the 10% of startups that have applied for a patent, 81% of those have applied for a European patent. So already in that very early stage, the focus is mainly on the European level rights. And that percentage rises to 88% for early stage financing and 92% for late stage financing. Then, moving on to the central results of the study, which are the results of the econometric analysis we have conducted, which was to answer the basic question, is activity in patenting or trademarking associated with a higher probability of achieving subsequently? So basically what we looked at is startups that applied for a trademark or a patent, and then whether they afterwards were able to obtain the different types of financing. And you see here the results that basically confirm that hypothesis. If we look at the early stage financing, for example, we see that companies or startups that applied for a trademark were four times more likely to obtain financing than startups that did not. If we look at patents, they were six times more likely to obtain financing than those that did not apply for patents or trademarks. And when we look at the combination of the two IP rights, then startups that applied for both patents and trademarks were 10 times as likely to achieve financing as startups that did not apply for any IP rights. So this is a very, very powerful result indicating a strong connection between activity in trademark or patent and the subsequent ability to obtain financing. As I said before, when there is an especially strong association between the ability to obtain financing and applying for European level as opposed to national level rights. And this is especially pronounced when it comes to early stage financing. If you look at the right part of this chart, then you see that for startups that applied for a European trademark, the probability of obtaining financing is six times higher than for startups that did not apply for any trademark, compared to twice as high for startups that applied for a national trademark. Looking at patents, startups that applied for a national patent were about four times as likely to obtain financing as those that did not, but those that applied for a European patent were more than five times as likely to obtain financing than those that did not. So in other words, what we see is that the act of applying for an IP right seems to act as a signaling device to potential investors that this startup is serious, that this startup has ideas that are worth protecting by applying for IP rights. And this in turn has a strong influence on the ability, on the willingness of those investors to invest in those startups. Now, of course, the startups, the companies, the venture capital firms that invest in those startups don't do it for altruistic reasons. They do it because they want to, in the end, make a profit on their investment. And the way they make a profit on their investment is that down the line, they either sell the company that they invested into another company, or they float it on the stock market through an initial public offering. So we also, in this study, looked at the probability or the likelihood of being able to obtain such a successful exit, as we call it, as a function of or related to having applied for trademarks or patents in advance. And we see that there is indeed a connection. So startups that applied for trademarks are twice as likely to achieve a subsequent successful exit than startups that did not. When it comes to patents, they are 2.5 times as likely to obtain a successful exit. And those that apply for both patent and trademarks are more than 3 times as likely to obtain a successful exit. And again, I stress the importance of the exit strategy because, again, the investors who invest in those startups do it in order to obtain a successful exit. Without an assessment that they are likely to get that, they will never invest in the early stages. So this is an extremely important finding. So in summary, what we see is that a bit less than one third of European startups have applied for trademarks or patents and thereby use them to exploit, to protect their individual intellectual assets and to try to gain a financing advantage. The results clearly show that having applied for a patent or a trademark has an leads to an increased probability of obtaining financing, whether it's in the early stages or in the seed financing or late stage financing. And this is especially true when the startup has filed for European level rights and or for a combination of patents and trademarks. And this, the fact that the combination of patents and trademarks has a particularly strong influence makes perfect sense, because the act of applying for a patent signals to investors that the company has an innovation that is worthy of patent protection. And the act for applying for a trademark signals to investors that the company has a product or service that it is about to bring to the marketplace and thereby earn revenue, which is in the end is what this is all about. So this combination of innovation and marketing is particularly powerful, it appears. And finally, what we see is that the prior filing of patents and trademarks is also associated with a higher probability of a subsequent successful exit, whether merger, acquisition, or IPO for the investors. And again, what we see that the strongest predictive power is again associated with a combination of patents and trademarks, rather than just a single IP right. So in summary, the answer to the basic question we asked at the outset of the study is yes. The act of applying for IP rights is associated with a higher probability of obtaining financing for startups. And there is a very important lesson in that. Thank you.
Thank you, Nathan. And thank you, Yann, for this very insightful presentation. Well, it's clear now that patents and trademarks lead to better chances of funding and successful exit as well. So I'm definitely thinking about applying myself, Yann. I will need your help, I guess, to get a bright idea. If you have any questions or reactions to the presentations, let us know in the chat and we will answer them after our session at the end. And if you're interested to learn more about the study, you can check the link below on your screen that appears, or just go online and to epo.org/startup-finance. Yann, we're now going to unveil the Deep Tech Finder, your new tool that you're launching today. What am I going to find there?
Well, you will for sure find a number of very exciting startups and maybe your next investment opportunity.
Okay, well, that sounds promising. So without further ado, to present you the Deep Tech Finder, here is Jeremy Philpott.
Stéphane, thank you for that kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, the patent system is quite easily the oldest system for knowledge transfer. It's been around for centuries, and the EPO has a mission to share technical information. But we also know that outsiders find it difficult to navigate the huge amounts of technical information that we curate, and it's often very difficult to understand how that information might be relevant to a certain business situation. This is where our Deep Tech Finder is a unique and new proposition, and it's completely free. What we are doing is we are connecting two different worlds of data: the business world with information on the age of a company, the strength of a company, how big it is, how much money it's received in investment, for example. And on the other side, we have patent data, not just the technical information in it, but whether or not applications are pending or have been granted. So diving in, what you can see is that we have systematically matched all of the European startups in the database at Dealroom with their patent applications, if they have them, in our European patent register. And this has yielded a cohort of over 7,500 startups which have got European patent applications or granted European patents. Now, this tool is a major leap forward because there are numerous providers of business information out there, but no one has ever before blended together that business information with patent information in the way that we have done it. And what's more, we're giving it away for free. So the easiest search that you could do is you go looking for a particular company name. Let's say it's Digas, because you've heard about their activities up in Riga. And so here they are. They've come as a little blue dot on the map. And we can now look at them and we can see they've got a website. So let's go and take a look at that. And they are in decarbonization of rail fleets. Very worthwhile thing to be doing. And we can look at their funding history according to their profile in Dealroom. And here it comes, nothing like live TV. And we can see how much investments they've received, other financial information, and so on. So we're blending this business information with their patent information. And we can add them to our list of startups. And then we can come in here and we can take a look and hey presto, this is the patent application that is for this company. Some companies have one patent application, some have many more. So what we've been able to do with this tool is, as you can see, we have a map here. We have quite literally put European startups with patents on the map. And we can now leverage that patent knowledge to help you find startups in an extremely granular way. What we've got, for example, is we've got these searchable fields. We can look at them, obviously, by country. You know, it's a map, but you can select countries. We've got their growth stages. So if you're looking for companies at a particular stage in their growth journey, you can select for that. Dealroom has over 30 industry categories. Okay, so let's pick, for example, security. And we've also got all of these technology fields. And I'll speak a little bit more about those in a moment. But even if you were to do a search just by industry, what you will find here, for example, and we can zoom in here and we can find in an industry, we've got Secure Knock, and we can find out what they're up to. And what we can see is that they are into cybersecurity. And again, we can look at their funding history in Dealroom. They've got three patent applications. If we add them to our list, then we can go and have a look at their patent applications and so on. But we can go one better than this. If we now start resetting our filters, we could, for example, let's go and look at wearable tech. So wearables is a very popular area at the moment. So some wearables are built into textiles. They certainly have a sports application. They have a wellness application. But we can now blend this with some of the relevant patent areas. So we have some 4,000 patent examiners here at the EPO. And they have provided us with the information that helps us differentiate all these different technical fields according to patents. And at the moment, we've done this into two main areas. We have so-called smart industry, which is everything to do with artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, fourth industrial revolution, digital transformation, you know, all of these terms that we use. But also outside of smart industry, we could also be searching, for example, for clean energy. So you've got electrolysis, wind energy, solar, uses of clean energy, so green cement, green steel, but also, in completely different search would be, let's go and look at battery tech. This is an area that's of very, very hot interest at the moment. But anyway, you saw as I clicked through here, I was selecting, please help, yep, there you are. I selected healthcare in combination with some of the industries for fashion and sports. So this is going to lead us to wearables. And what we should find then, if we zoom out, here we go. We should find some companies active in wearables. And we've got here a company in Manchester. And again, we can start looking at their profile. Interesting company. We can see that they are making wearable tech for sports performance. They've got connected apparel. They are boasting about the fact that they've got some patents, which is good. So we can then obviously click through to Deal Room, look at their funding profile, and we can go and take a look at them. So here's Prevail, and there you are. They have a handful of patent applications. They're all quite new. And if we were to click through onto some of these, we would quickly find their profiles in our patent database. So this is one of their patents. And, you know, it's a whole other story about navigating patent information. I'm not going to labor that point here. But you can then from there find out if the patent's in force and so on. So the tool enables you to drill down into all of this information, and you can do it in a very, very granular way, depending on whether or not you want to focus on which stage of growth they're at and so on. Now, one of the other searches that you can do is an investor search. So why don't we take a look at the European Innovation Council, given that they are also our honored guest today. And here we find that European Innovation Council has backed over 790 of the startups that we currently have in the tool. So that means they're behind more than 10% of everything in the tool. So if you've got any questions, maybe they're answered by our FAQ. That's also in here. So, but otherwise, you know, just come and have a look and come and play around. Where will you find it? Well, it's here inside the new web pages of the Observatory on Patents and Technology. And go and take a look for yourselves. And maybe you'll find your next technology partner or your next investor or maybe even your next unicorn. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeremy, for this great demo of a new generation tool. It looks super easy to use, and in many ways, maybe not only to find your next investor, but also to find your next competitor. Who knows? So we're going to discuss now with our panelists on how deep tech startups can leverage on all this. So Yann, you are still with us here. Thank you. And let me welcome next to me, Michiel Scheffer. And joining us online are Eoghan Hickey, Rhona Togher, and Jürgen Stamfold. Welcome, everyone. I remind you that you can ask your question in the chat anytime, and we will have a dedicated Q&A session at the end. So let me start very quickly with a quick question of a reaction on the demo that we've just seen. Anyone who wants to react, maybe? I know that when we've been preparing, Michiel, you said that you knew the tool quite well. Now that you see it online?
Well, I'm a geographer, so I love maps because seeing the world on a map enables you to see highlights, ecosystems with a lot of startups, with a lot of patents. And it also shows you regions or places where there's much less. So it's a very important guide strategically for us as EIC to see the disparities, but also which ecosystems work. And I think it's essential for an applicant or a beneficiary to see, well, what has already been done in my trade with my competitors, so you can see how you distinguish yourself from the others. So it's both strategically and operationally a very important tool, and I'm very happy that it happened because it's I like to do policy by facts, and this gives us a fact base to improve our policies.
Right, thank you. Professor, I was seeing that you wanted to react on the tool and maybe you had a question or something?
Actually, not yet.
Oh, not yet. Okay, fine. So anyone wants to react? Eoghan, Rhona? No.
Yes,
no,
I think on my side, it's a very useful tool. It's something which brings a lot of extra granularity to the search. It's not only about the state of the art. It's not only about understanding where the clusters are, but if you're developing technology in a certain field, your peers are based. You know where the HR valleys are going to be on recruitment as well. There's a lot of extra insights I think you derive from these kind of, you know, continental topologies of technology. So there's a lot more there. Patenting and patenting strategy is a large domain. There are lots of facets and layers to it, and this is an eminently useful tool I think for people to start playing with.
Thank you, Owen. So let me kick off the conversation with you, Michiel, to start. So you are the president of the European Innovation Council. You have roughly a 10 billion budget, and you invested in a portfolio of 400 plus startups as of now, I guess. You are collaborating with the EPO as well. Can you tell us more about this collaboration?
Yeah, just to be precise, we have around 700 beneficiaries. So that is companies using grants or funds. And the accelerator is a blended instrument with grants and fund. And we have currently around 400 companies in which the fund has invested. That makes the EIC fund the largest investor in high tech, in deep tech in Europe now. And it will grow every 6 months. So by end of 27, we will be the largest investor worldwide in deep tech.
Wow.
So that's a strategic instrument created by the European Commission to basically boost the transfer of research to innovation and to really create a new generation of startups that will, well, realize a change in green energy, in the Green Deal, in digitalization, and also in affordable health. So it was, let's say we invest in companies with a societal impact, and of course, we are happy if we make an economic revenue out of it.
I guess. And how do you collaborate with the European Patent Office?
In different ways. I mean, the first thing is very important to realize for all applicants and all beneficiaries that an active intellectual property policy is essential. It's an evaluation criteria. And therefore, the EPO also helps the EIC in identifying the applicants and to validate or to check their IP position, because that's an important criteria to evaluate proposals. So that's one important thing. The second thing is it's not a static thing. So when companies are using our instruments, we expect of them to strengthen their IP position. And for doing so, they can have help from the training packages that the EPO offers. That's the second one. And the third thing is, like the Deep Tech Finder, but there are others as well, there's a horizon scanning done by the EPO, which is basically an examination of the tech trends. And that helps us to evaluate, but also it's available for the beneficiaries. It's available online. So basically, people can also see what deep tech trends are happening. Because the European policies are always fact-based, and we want those facts also to be available for the public.
Thank you. And in the past, you've been talking about the Death Valley of startups. Can you tell us a little bit more, elaborate on that, and tell us whether IP and patents are probably helping in on the road?
Well, what is important is we only fund, as EIC, deep tech startups. And basically, deep tech startups also have a long and deep valley of death. So they have 4, 5, 6 years of development of going from TRL 3 to TRL 8. So it's hardship. I know those startups that basically have 5 years of costs only and no revenue. So we are really, let's say, a long-term investor helping startups that have a long period of development before they can prove that something works in a body, in a car, in a landscape. So the overcoming the value of death is very important, and a lot of startups have very short value of death, and so they have revenue after 6 months or a year, that they should look for other funding instruments, and they exist in the world.
Okay, thank you. Owen, I think you're an investor as well, but obviously from a different perspective. Can you tell us more about probably as a starter about Jolt and the positioning and your investment strategy so that everyone understands where you're coming from?
Yes, of course. So contrary to the EIC, Jolt is a much later stage investor. So we are typically in the scaling up phase rather than the starting up phase. So beyond that valley of death that was referred to, this is typically where we're placed, but very much on deep tech. And for us, that's both hardware and software. And what we bring is a very active collaborative support as a shareholder. We are working with companies and shareholders as real peers and partners, taking our data-driven meritocratic approach to scale responsibly tech companies. The stage of investment we're at is approximately when companies have a real market traction. For us, that's in the range of 10 million or so euros of revenues with a degree of flexibility. So we are a little bit later stage. Those companies have some maturity at that point in time. They should have IP. But as was said earlier as well, it's not a static thing. It's a domain. It requires a roadmap. because as all investors, to some extent, we're buying the future, not the past. So we need proof that the past was great, but that the future can also be brighter.
Okay, when we were preparing this conversation, you mentioned something about storytelling in your financing. Can you tell us more about that and how you approach IP in general?
Approaching IP is, well, we approach companies. IP is just one component in possibly thousands of parameters which are going to factor into a decision to invest or not. But again, we're looking for best of breed companies. We want the top decile, the top quartile. That's our only way to be the best. IP is a part of it, and a roadmap is probably going to secure that in the future. You know, that saying, excellent is some, it's a habit, not an action. So the roadmap is important. The patent strategy is important. So companies should understand the cost, the timelines, the cost of enforcement, the trade-offs of quality and quantity, what to patent, not to patent. And these are things which people learn along the way. So we have a degree of expertise and knowledge and background in these areas. But we want to have those discussions with companies. Because again, as I said at the beginning, we're peers and partners with them. On the company side, they need to project a future, which is one of an infinity number of futures, but it's their really role during the fundraising process to create that storytelling, that compelling, coherent, credible story of the future, which is well-formed, balanced, versatile, with reasonable assumptions. And they need to demonstrate that execution capability. There are many things that they cannot control. They don't know when the market lifts off. They don't know if their hirings were always optimized. But the things they can't control, and building an IP portfolio is something directly within their control. And building that robustly over time, it can be done organically with their own research and development and filing. It can sometimes be done and supplemented inorganically with the licensing and perhaps acquisition. And these are things directly in the company's control, because again, we invest in companies, not so much in people. People are very important components, but primarily we're looking to build shareholder value so that we can then build the companies into be something much more larger in the future.
Which is rather different from what we hear a lot actually at VivaTech, is that you invest in people. That's what we hear a lot of time. But I see that on the deep tech field, it's much more you invest in the companies, because as you said, when people are leaving, you need to have something that it's left somewhere in the company. And IP is a form of securing investment for you.
Exactly. Typically, when the investor enters, we're looking to get our money back at a point and give that back to our investors. So there must be something transferable. We're not investing in services companies where the IP or the special sauce or the key know-how is inside people's heads. There must be something transferable when someone is to acquire the company, or if the company goes public. Again, you need to onboard people and train people. So having some, you know, really embedded tangible value on what the company is doing is really core. It's fundamental and foundational, I think, to getting investment, again, from deep tech investors. As we said earlier, there is different domain of investors which are looking at scaling up different types of companies. And that's also a key component for, I think, companies to look at. Investors are not homogeneous. We all have slightly different strategies, different areas of domain, and we look at different things. And it's important to understand, probably from the company's perspective, what are the incentives that would get an investor to buy into their strategy.
Michiel, you wanted to react.
Yeah, you wouldn't use the word tangible, but it's an important word, that patents are an asset, and it's a tradable asset, whereas the people in a company are not tradable, luckily. So that's something important, and strategically the objective of the ESC is to increase the value of European assets. So that's the value of patents altogether, that either are developed, industrialized by the startup itself, but more often the patent will be licensed out for manufacturing, or licensed out for manufacturing and commercialization. So it's quite important to have that. We hope, of course, that as many of those patents are industrialized by European companies, but in some areas we have to be realistic. Americans are, for example, in medical technology, much stronger, and often it's an asset that is being tradable to US companies, but it's the ownership of the original patents still remains, we hope, in Europe.
Okay, got it. Well, as a matter of fact, we have two great entrepreneurs with a lot of assets joining us today. So, and they have also great storytelling. So Rhona, I'm turning to you. Can you tell us more about LIOS and the company and what was the journey out there? You started at a really young age, I've been told. Is that correct? Like 18, 19 years old?
Yes, we were 18 when we founded the company. I'm Rhona Togher, I'm the CEO and co-founder of LIOS. We're based in Dublin in Ireland. And what we make are advanced acoustic materials that are more powerful, thinner, lighter, and sustainable. And it's being adopted across construction, automotive, aerospace, home appliances, anywhere that there's noise pollution, really. And thanks to the EIC, we have been well-funded in our research and our ability to protect our intellectual property. But yes, we founded the business as a school science project when we were overexposed to loud noise as younger adults. And we became incredibly passionate about protecting our hearing and raising awareness about how we can prevent avoidable hearing damage. And we've dedicated the last decade to acoustic research and development and improving on these materials. And I think there are ways in which you can see the trends that are coming, you know, these industries that have been stagnant, that have lacked innovation, that can see massive regulations coming their way. You can see that change will happen, but it will happen slowly. So for these deep tech companies that are looking to invest in their research and development, that is the perfect time for exposing and generating new technologies for those industries that haven't maybe been as innovative as they could have been over the years. So we've been working on our technology now for almost a decade, and it's almost time to come to market. So as these deep tech troughs come and go, it takes a very long time to build out the technology and, of course, build your intellectual property around that as well. We filed our first patent, I think we were 19 at the time, in 2010. And it was an incredibly long journey from filing our initial filing to actually becoming a granted patent all across Europe and America and the rest of the world. So as a deep tech company as well, it's really good to understand that when you file your intellectual property, you're just starting the journey of protecting all of your innovations. And it will continue to grow and, as Eoghan says, continue to build on that and become more valuable as your business gets older.
Thank you. And can you go into specifics how IP was instrumental or decisive in your growing journey? What was the accelerator, the boost that it gave you, when and where?
Of course. As a small company, it's critical for funding. You know, everyone is going to value you based on your assets. And as we know, it's a tangible asset, your intellectual property, what you're building now and what you're building in the future. If you can show that roadmap that people are mentioning as well, where you're building on what you currently have and you can show, well, this is what we're actually going to develop and it's going to disrupt the world fundamentally. But beyond just getting funding, you know, you need to have customers as a business, and those customers are going to be evaluating you from top to toe when they're looking at utilizing your technology, especially when it's going to be something like ours, so disruptive and as such a big change to what's been a really ubiquitous industry around one material for such a long time. So they need to be able to evaluate your technology and see how robust and substantial it is. So every single company they're with is doing a full intellectual property review of our technology and our business before they even begin to work with us, to know that we have really strong assets that we can hold on to, that they can leverage then in the future when it comes to further partnerships and licensing in the future.
Okay, got it. Jorgen, you've been also doing patents from the very beginning of your strategy at Cubicure. So you are the founder and CEO of a company in the 3D printing business, if I can put it very simple, in simple words. Do you relate to what Rhona was saying? I mean, you're obviously on a much later stage, but I think the patents and IP was very critical from the beginning in your strategy, right?
Yeah, but I agree with everything that has been said. Our company was originating from the university research, where I am professor for materials and additive manufacturing. And we filed first IP already at the university, which then later on was licensed to the company. And this definitely is very helpful because, as mentioned, IP is a tangible asset. And in the very early stages of a deep tech startup, there's not much tangible assets around. So IP definitely helps in terms of evaluating the company in its early stages. So that's what I can agree on with what has been said before. But it goes beyond that, in my view. Also in deep tech, startup means you have lots of inventors in the company, and they are very proud of their inventions, obviously, and they have to be proud of it and very convinced of it. But you should also be a little bit skeptical of what you have. Also, you need to check at a very early stage, how about your freedom to operate, right? What are your competitors doing? Which IP do they have that might conflict with your product? You should also look at, I would, as in my experience, there's also a difference between the various markets you are entering. So we are doing lots of activity in biomedical engineering, and there IP is highly relevant, and not only IP, but you need to have exclusive rights on your IP, otherwise no one will even talk to you, so to say. In other industries like automotive industry or food industry, things are a little bit different. There it's more important to match prices of competitors and to have a good trademark maybe. But especially in biomedical engineering, IP is absolutely critical. So this determines your valuation in the beginning, but also in later stages. And it also helps to keep your margins high, right? So how can you keep margins on a high level? One way to do that is to have a technological moat, and this technological moat can be somehow brought down to the IP rights you own. So overall, in my experience, IP, especially in fields like biomedical engineering, pharmaceutical engineering, and similar industries, is of high relevance. And filing IP at an early stage makes it easier to be also a little bit critical on what you have, right? So if you have the great invention in your view and you submit it to the patent office and you get back a list of lots of XXXXX, so this helps to become a little bit more realistic what you have. So in my experience, IP plays a very crucial role from the beginning, but also in later stages when your company is evaluated for an exit, for example.
Thank you, Professor. And so you are obviously on the other side of the spectrum, because you recently done a successful exit with your company, who's been acquired by Align Technology. How did it play in the exit strategy?
We worked with Align for a very long time, actually. And whenever, because we had some joint development agreements with them, and so we got closer and closer. That's also a little bit of a difference if you're dealing with a strategic investor or with a financial investor. So there are the rules, I would say, are a little bit different depending if you're talking to strategic or financial investors. As in our case, we mostly dealt with strategic investments. And again, as IP was always, as we had lots of discussions in defining our contracts for our joint development agreements, but also later on for the purchase agreements. Licensing agreements and IP, I would say, it's a painful process anyway, making all these contracts and due diligence, and that's really a tough time when you have to go through that. Roughly estimating, I would say, in our case, of all these efforts we had to make, IP was certainly 30-40% of the overall effort. This is probably the largest. As they were some financial topics, some legal topics, and so on. So as the individual topic, IP played by far the largest role in discussing all those transactions.
Okay, thank you. And I heard also that you filed for a unitary patent recently. So I was wondering, actually, was it before or after your exit?
Actually, before. So we was not much before, and independent of this transaction. We filed for that. I cannot say too much yet, because we haven't gotten too much interaction with the EPO yet. But I guess this will be helpful. So for startups, you might easily be overwhelmed, right? These patent patent laws and all these regulations. So that's easily overwhelming a small company. You don't have a dedicated patent officer in a small company typically. So the management has to deal with that with the help of a patent counsel usually. But anyway, it's a complicated topic and you might easily be overwhelmed here. And this unitary patent, as in our view, and we hope this will in practical terms also the case, makes your life easier, right? It's easier to file a unitary patent than to file the European patent and then nationalize everything, deal with translations and all of that. So I think this will be helpful for deep tech startups. Where I don't have experience yet is how it will help in terms of also defending your IP, right? So that's then in later stages, you might have to defend your intellectual property rights. As I could guess, in such a stage, it will also be beneficial if you deal with unitary patent, because that's making it less likely that you have to carry on fights in 20 different European countries if you have to defend your IP. So overall, I think this will be a very helpful tool for startups.
Thank you, Professor. Owen, I was curious, are you engaging your startups now to file for a unitary patent as much as possible, or is that one of your strategy to leverage as much on this? Or are they free to go the route they want in some ways?
They are free to go the route they want, but our view is quite simple. The most efficient way is the best way. And if they have certain preferences, ways of working and knowledge in certain areas, we can accept that. Again, we're taking a data-driven approach. We're not here to impose things. We're here to partner with companies. We like a velocity of filings, certainly, I would say. We don't know which, if any, of the IP filed are going to be, you know, top centile, top decile, top ventile quality patents. So there is a degree of quantity over quality. And that's really getting into the kind of the more nuances of what is a patenting strategy, if it's a foundational patent, a dependent patent, because patents can be contested. You can lose them, but if you lose one and it's everything, that's not good. Of course, if you lose one within a family or an array of patents which are protecting a key technology, of course, it's the risk, the downside is much lower. So we look at things in a relatively sophisticated way, and that's a conversation with the companies. Again, so it's not to impose, it's to mentor, collaborate. They will need some resources internally. As we said, it is a little bit complex. So you need to have people on the inside of the company which are doing it. As shareholders, we are not executive in the company, but we are taking quite a hands-on role, I would say, to make sure that, again, that these decisions are taken today, because they are investments, not costs.
Okay. And I was curious from both your perspectives as entrepreneurs and investors. Let's do the do's and don'ts. What are the absolute no-go first things to avoid when it comes to IP? I mean, obviously, we understand that you need to rush and protect your ideas and your innovation and go to IP, but there are some pitfalls on that. What would be your recommendations? Who wants to start?
Yes, maybe if I can start. As a filing IP is critical and needs to be done. And you can make things wrong there and make things right. But I would say that the critical phase is later on when you negotiate about, for example, licensing your IP or maybe selling or offering exclusive rights to someone. As at this phase, that's in my experience really super critical, because if you negotiate a contract and give away something which is crucial for your company because you need the money urgently or because you're not a good negotiator, so during such negotiations, within 5 or 10 or 15 minutes, you can more or less waste all the work that has been done in years or even decades before. So negotiating such IP-related contracts, that's in my view a really critical stage for a deep tech startup, because you can do things right there, obviously, but you can really crash your company if you don't negotiate such contracts with a high degree of professionalism.
Rhona, you are about to go to market. So, and licensing is also, I think, one of your strategy to leverage on your IP. Is that correct?
That is, and I would completely agree with everything that's just been said. You know, being incredibly careful about what you're giving away when you're partnering with these companies. Partnerships, licensing, joint development agreements, protecting your intellectual property and the intellectual property that comes out of that as well. You never know what you're going to discover when you're in the middle of a project with another company and what might be developed from that and how valuable that might be for your business. So protecting every single asset you have and every asset that you might have is incredibly important. And as we come to launch on the market now, those contracts are being worked out and they are incredibly long and very important for us to be as strong as possible so that we end up in the best position that we can be when we launch on the market and as we continue to develop our technology further. So yes, those contracts with your partners and your customers are critical.
Thank you, Michiel.
What is essential, and the two stories of Rhona and Jürgen are very compelling and exactly what we want as an EIC, but what is very important is IP is like a garden. You have to maintain it. You have to sow, you have to weed, you have to harvest, you have to clean it up in the winter. And the two big risks is either to pay too much to a university for getting a patent, and the second one is to get too little from a company for licensing out. And all of them have to sometimes license out part of the technology simply to have another cash revenue. And so that's also, so you can fully license out, you can partly license out. But what is very important, that's why training is important, and I'm very happy with the partnership with the EPO. It's important to have a good strategy and to be trained on IP.
Okay. Owen, do you have any advice as an investor?
Again, if I keep it quite simplistic, we like companies to make haste, but slowly. So you have to go as fast as you can, but tread cautiously, meaning procrastination is the real enemy. Again, it is filing IP is a long process. It's a habit without a finish line. It's something that needs to be undertaken. And the quicker and earlier, I think, companies engage in it, that complexity falls away. And like anything, the more exposure they have to something, the more familiarity and the more confidence they have with it and see it as a tool to be used. So it's something to be engaged head on, I think, without delay.
Yann, you wanted to add something.
Yes, perhaps another point very, very much related to what has been said is it's important to have a proactive approach to IP and to patents. So it's not only about ticking the box of having filed a patent. It has to be thought through. It has to be aligned with the business. So it has to be strategic and aligned with the business strategy.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all. I see time is running, sadly. I'm sure we could talk about this extensively all day long. And we have a lot of questions coming in. So let me welcome again Nathan, who's joining us back for the Q&A. And let's dig into this. So we have a first question for you, Michiel. So do you think the VC community are generally aware of the correlation between IP and growth potential? Or is there a challenge to convince them that this is important to invest in IP at an early stage?
Well, the VC community is a community with clans, but the deep tech clan is convinced, and we had an example with Owen, the deep tech VC community is convinced that IP is essential in the value creation of their portfolios.
Okay, Owen, do you want to, as an investor as well, do you want to react? Or I guess, I mean, you know that there is a correlation and it's quite clear now.
Yes, it's a foundational building block. Like we said, we're investing to build something. We want to build that great big castle of the future with the companies and build those large enterprises. We have to have alignment. We have a certain belief that technology is going to enable us to resolve many of these critical problems, which were mentioned earlier too. That's the journey we want to finance. The companies that we will finance will be aligned with us or not. They will basically fall outside of our investment mandate. So this is a key component. So building IP, it's a must have.
Okay. And the next question is for you, Owen, actually. Someone is asking, what comes first? Is it VC funding or is it IP rights? Is it because VCs have invested that more IP rights are... And I don't see the end of the questions. If someone can turn to the next page, sorry about that. Well, actually, the question is quite clear. Like, what in terms of timing, what comes first, the IP or the VC?
I think as a later stage investor, we are slightly biased to Jolt Capital because we are investing in companies which are slightly more mature. But this is a complex question. There's a degree of circularity here, but there's also a lot of momentum in the market. The companies which prove themselves or illustrate themselves or demonstrate themselves to be best of breed at the earlier stages, that momentum tends to be magnetic. Those companies get flooded with resources and other similar companies might miss out. So it's not always clear if what is the key component. Quite depressingly, at the very early stages, you see the predictor, which is most, the parameter that's most predictive of future success to raise money is how much money was raised previously, because money is enabling companies to go further. So EIC are doing a critically important thing here by financing this kind of Death Valley zone where companies can't easily get financing available. To get a VC to come on board, that tends to be quite nuanced vis-a-vis the particular strategy of the VC. But there is, it's not a fair world. There's laws of the jungle here. Momentum is key. But dealing with the specific investors is also key. So it's one of those horrible answers. It depends. There's no particular, I think, strategy which works in all scenarios.
Okay. And Yann, I see you want to react maybe as an EPO perspective.
Yes, actually, that's a question we have been encountering in preparing the study. And so what we see in the data is that both effects coexist. Actually, we see very clearly that the startup accumulate more IP as they get more funding, so and as they obtain more results, that makes sense. But when we compare also two startups operating same age, operating in the same sector, seeking, for instance, early stage investment, one with patent or with trademark, one without, the one with a patent or trademark is more likely to raise funding. So you have two effects at play, and including the effect of IP driving investment.
Thank you. Michiel, you wanted to react, no?
Yeah, shortly, we have three instruments, a Pathfinder and Transition. It's the perspective of an IP that is essential, but for the accelerator, we expected that there's already initial IP, a first patent that is, let's say, applied for.
Okay, thank you all. Rhona, there's questions for you. Would your startup exist today without patent protection? Big question. And would other IP strategies, e.g. secrecy, for example, have been sufficient in the absence of patent protection?
Sufficient? No, I don't think so. But we do utilize a combination of both. And I think having a detailed patent strategy does encompass both protected intellectual property rights, know-how, trade secrets. You do need to have variety in your garden, as we've discussed today. You know, you can't just rely on one element. You need to have something else that is just yours for now, even if you do protect it in the future. And I don't think our company would exist today without our intellectual property. And from our perspective, the IP came before the funding. And every single time we pitch for funding or we meet with investors or companies, the first question is always, tell us about your intellectual property strategy, because they need to know that we've protected those rights, how well protected they are, where they're protected, and the level that we've gone to protect them. So for us, it's a really critical component of everything we do within our business and everything that we plan to do in the future as well. It's going to be a huge part of how we scale our company, how we grow, and how we expand in every market that we're going into as well. So for us, IP is critical and it is the first step.
Okay. And Jorgen, as your perspective, do you think that the unitary patent is even more important for a startup than larger companies?
One comment also to what has been said before. My advice would also be take care of your clients. So that's what in deep tech startups frequently happens. People are just talking about technology and investments, and no one likes to talk about clients anymore. So that's something you shouldn't forget. If you finally, it's the clients that pay your bills, and you have to learn how to deal with clients at an early stage, not doing development for 5-6 years, hoping that in 6 years someone will buy your product. So don't forget about clients. And in terms of unitary patents, that's definitely helpful for for SMEs, also in deep tech startups in special, because as mentioned, all these IP filing strategies, they get complex anyway. And if you have to deal with individual countries on a large number, this doesn't make your life easier. So a unitary patent is definitely something that will change some of the rules in the game. And ideally, I hope at some point it will be comparable to a US patent, because also if you file patents, everyone will tell you you need definitely US patent. Then people have different strategies how to deal with PCT and European patents. But I think that should be the goal, that this European unitary patent is worth as much as a US patent. I think this should be the goal of this strategy.
Okay, thank you. Yann, what are the possible future developments for the Deep Tech Finder? Can you tell us more?
Sure. So there are a number of developments that are foreseen. So obviously, we need in the first place to keep updating this tool. Startups keep being created, or some of them are dying. So we need to maintain that. We are also very curious about the first feedback that we get from users. The tool is launched today. Certainly, there are improvements that are possible. We need to collect this information and feed it back into the design of the tool. But actually, we already have some changes and some evolutions that are planned. So I will not disclose it now, but we are already working on it. And there was also the question on university spin-outs. So that's a very interesting question indeed. So the tool currently features a number of university spin-outs, 500, I think, in the tool, that benefited from university investments. But for the moment, the tool is limited to spin-outs or startups that have filed their own European patents. So we know that a number of other spin-outs are licensing a patent from their university. They are very interesting as well. So this is something we are closely watching now.
Michiel, you wanted to react?
I hope two things. One is that there's also, in some stage, a correlation emerging between publications and patents, because sometimes publications lead to patents. So then we have the full flow of, let's say, the funnel from fundamental knowledge to application. And I hope that you keep a category dead SMEs and dead startups, because one can learn so much of failures. And it's important to keep that also for historical reasons in the database, but make it the specific category, but don't remove them.
We do.
Okay, so it's already on its way. Owen, there's a question for you. How valued are patents alone as an independent asset? If the startup fails to develop the invention and generate value above and beyond the IP assets, can IP be sold on its own and redeployed to other companies? How liquid is the market for patents for failed startup? It's a great question.
It's difficult to start putting monetary values on patents, but what it does do, it gives a much greater degree of strategic flexibility. So for a company that has failed to achieve its primary goal or its match their technology to the market, it gives them a second bite of the cherry, not quite a resurrection, but I think it's certainly reasonable that they could consider merging with other companies who perhaps have the assets, the capital, the resources that they need to give them a second chance to apply their technology and solutions in other areas. With IP, with a strong IP portfolio, that's a reasonable conversation to have to another company. Again, many startups require somewhat similar things. They need people. They want money to hire people to actually implement and develop projects. So I think with IP, it gives you a chance. It gives you a chance at survival, and perhaps sometimes surviving long enough enables you to thrive later on when the world changes, when there's a greater acceptance of the solution that you've brought. So technology brings that agility, versatility. So it's not easy to put a monetary value on it, but it basically gives you a much greater downside and flexibility if things go wrong.
Okay, so it's almost a lifeline. Rhona, startups often have the problem of bearing the cost of IP, and it's true, we didn't discuss that yet in the beginning. How did you do that? Do you have any advice for fellow entrepreneurs online? Can you hear us, Rhona? Are you with us? I think we lost the connection with Rhona, but maybe Eoghan.
I think what is most important to be aware of is the cost doesn't come up front. Everything.
Okay, so I think we have a slight connection problem with Rhona. Eoghan, I mean, you're an entrepreneur as well. And it was you had that strategy from the beginning. What was the cost for you? Was it a burden or?
Yeah, definitely. Also, that's and it gets more expensive every year. We had some joint development agreements where we could share the cost, but basically this has to be paid out of your cash flow, wherever the cash flow comes from. But I would still recommend everyone to carry this burden because it's definitely worth the money in the long run. But it's not cheap to maintain your IP portfolio and to strengthen it. Also, the largest cost in our case mostly came from the patent councils or from external councils. So filing and also in the early years of maintaining the patent is not the major cost. So the cost is mostly coming from the patent councils.
Rhona, I think you're back with us. Is that right?
Yes, I hope so. Yes. So from our perspective, what I think it's really important for SMEs to know if they haven't begun on their IP journey yet is that the costs aren't all upfront. They're spread out over many years. So when you hear how expensive it's going to be, which it can be, but it's not all upfront. It is incremental. So you have time to raise capital, develop your technology further, get customers so that you're not, that burden doesn't all come at once. And the unitary patent will also change that. It will really streamline the fees for SMEs. So it will open that market of intellectual property that you may have felt cut off to many more companies. So there are many ways that you can get some intellectual property that you can build on your portfolio. And it's not a big intimidating bill just at the very beginning. It is spread out over a long period of time. You can build on that and you can grow your portfolio slowly but surely.
Okay, so that sounds a green line for everyone to rush and do IPs. Michiel, you're on the early stage as well.
Yeah, what I want to stress is that all the costs that beneficiaries make for protecting their IP are eligible costs in the Pathfinder transition and the accelerator. And I say to all those who are applying, don't be shy, budget it well, and take into account that the budget go up by time. So be on the safe side here and apply for enough funding.
Okay. I want to finish with maybe a question a bit broader because we are on the deep tech field here on the conversation. What are, in your views, the things that still needs to be done on the European level at many different levels to accelerate the growth of the deep tech scene in Europe? Because I think we all understand here that deep tech is key for the as an asset for Europe and its development and its positioning on the world. So do you have any... Michiel, you want to maybe too?
Well, the biggest challenge we have is that we, in the accelerators, our biggest instrument, we can go up to 17.5 million equity. That's always a minority share. So that makes, let's say, around 40, 50 million euros funding in total. That is not enough to create a new energy basis, a new materials basis. So what we really need is instruments that go further. And that's why we are very much in favor of what is called a STEP. That's the strategic investment plan of Europe, where basically we can go up to tickets of 250 million euros. That's really what we need to make Europe strategically autonomous.
Okay. Owen, do you have any wishes for the deep tech field that you are investing in?
Yes, of course. We've been advocating that for years in terms of we believe that deep technology sector is very important. And getting more capital there is also going to resolve some of the problems. We mentioned the US earlier in terms of how their market's different. And Europe has made lots and lots of progress. As it turns out, most of that progress is in the earlier phases of the company's growth. As companies hit the growth stage, that progress versus the US falls off to some extent. So there is a cliff hanging for some of those companies. So ensuring that we have the full life cycle of financing, those new instruments, which are mentioned, but those larger investors who can actually support companies with larger tickets and secure their future growth for longer periods. So getting more capital dedicated to particular phases of growth is key important. And that's exactly where Jolt Capital are targeted today.
Okay, thanks a lot. Rhona, maybe, or Eoghan, you want to add something here, or?
Yes, well, deep tech startups definitely have to do from the beginnings to think globally. Right? All these national markets, they are, so I'm coming from Austria, and we had a couple of university spin-offs, and none of them ever made more than 5-7% of its revenue in Austria. So you have to think globally from the beginning, and there a strong European Union will be very helpful, right? So that's what the US is a little bit easier. You have a big home market when you start, and this will be, in my view, very important for any deep tech startup, that we have a strong common European market, no nationalism on this level, and then you have to quickly go beyond Europe too. But thinking globally from day one, that's definitely important here.
Okay, thanks a lot. Well, I think we're approaching the end of our conversation and of our event. Time went by very quickly, and thank you all for this great exchange. We are going to reach the end of the event. And let me welcome Gilles Requena, the Chief Patent Research and Policy Officer of the European Patent Office, to share with us a few concluding words.
Yes, good morning, everyone, and with great pleasure, dear Stéphane. I will start by a warm thank to the presenters and panelists for the extremely interesting exchange of views and insight on startup and IP. I'm sure the participants of this first webinar will share my high appreciation of all the knowledge and experience they brought today. As you have certainly understood, the event today is not the end, but rather the start of our journey. The question is rather, can be expressed in rather simple terms. Innovation is key to provide the solutions which help to address most societal challenges. And startups are the backbone of innovation. I would add a certain dose of urgency. Whatever the political agenda, 2030, 2050, this is tomorrow in terms of the proper transition with all necessary investments. This is why at the EPO, we consider that starting the activity of the observatory with a deep look into the startup ecosystem and how it can be supported by the intellectual property was absolutely key. Today, the study showed that there is certainly an untapped potential for startups and investors in Europe. Too many startups are still unaware about what IP and patent simply mean. How to improve the situation? This is our joint responsibility. Of course, no one can bring alone the solution to those huge challenges. But if we continue to work in silos, each one feeling only responsible for its sole activity, there is very few chances we will succeed. And there is so much we can achieve by grouping our forces. For public authorities, it can take some time to deliver the proper regulatory framework, especially in Europe. But the combination of multiple experience and traditions can also help to produce unique tools, such as the unitary patents and the unified patent courts. These are newly game changers in the world of IP in Europe, as they help to overcome one of the new main obstacles, hindering development of the economic actors, particularly startups in our region, which is the fragmentation of the market. This first webinar was also a good illustration on how we, the EPO Observatory, intend to develop our activities. First, by providing solid and interesting material, such as study or the new tool, the Deep Tech Finder, freely accessible to the public. Second, by offering a plurality of views and perspectives, which represent well the diversity of stakeholders concerned by a topic. Thirdly, by linking policies and actors, because we don't want to produce theoretical input without impact. We were pleased to see today around the same table an institutional investors like the European Innovation Council, the representatives of two startups at different stages of development, LIOS and Cubicure, and venture capitalists like Jolt. And finally, by associating different expertise in order to provide the most comprehensive view on a topic. Today, we presented our study with our partner, the EUIPO. We are also very pleased to be supported by VIVA Technology for this event. They are the experts of the startup world, not us. So when addressing topics which are at the crossroads of different dimensions, IP, technology, economic, or societal, we will always look for complementary experiences. And this will offer opportunities for partnership with all interested actors. I invite you to look into our biennial work plan accessible on the website. Whenever you are interested in financing innovation, in the research universities and the patent activities in Europe, or with water-related technologies, I'm sure some topics will raise your interest. Our next activities will be dedicated to the carbon capture technologies early December, and later on, in February 2024, we will look into cancer fighting technologies. Finally, some technical announcements. If you like to watch all or part of this webinar, of course, you can have access quickly on EPO website. The webpage of the observatory will be updated very, very quickly with the material. Even more, if you would like to be trained in patent matters or if you would like to build a course around patent matters, feel free to access to all the material which is produced by the Patent Academy of the EPO, and which also it's freely accessible on our website. So this concludes my intervention, dear Stéphane. And again, a warm thanks to all the participants. And I'm very excited to continue this journey with you. And I hope to see you soon in our next and upcoming activities. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gilles. We are going to wrap things up here. IP, deep tech, startups, everything will be center stage during the next edition of VivaTech. We have some great speakers joining us as always, so stay tuned, and we're waiting for you in Paris next year in May. Today's event was only the beginning of a new chapter between the European Patent Office and the startup community. The Observatory on Patents and Technology will focus on startups and IP in the future. The new Deep Tech Finder platform is also just starting out, and it will be further improved, as we saw previously. So just go online, use it as much as possible to find your next investment or your next opportunity. The replay of this morning's discussion will be available on YouTube and LinkedIn on the European Patent Office account. Give us your feedback on today's event by clicking on the link we just posted in the chat and to help us shape future events. We are wishing all the best to the new Observatory, and thank you all for joining us today. A big thank you to our amazing panelists. Have a nice day, everyone.